Hey everyone, this is Michael again, and welcome back to the old channel here on YouTube. Well everyone, it's a month of horror. Almost. I'm a little bit late on the bandwagon, but I decided to dedicate the rest of this month to horror films and giving my thoughts on those movies, of course. But I'm a little bit late, like I said. It's half the month through now. But I decided I would, after the last video, which was a Phantasm review, I decided that I would jump forward and review some newer horror films. But then I thought, you know, I've never seen all the Phantasm films, so maybe I should stick with those movies and give my thoughts on those movies. So that's what I'm going to do. And if I'm able to get to any of the newer films, I'll go ahead and give my thoughts on those too. But what I have here is my box set of the Phantasm movies. This is an Anchor Bay release. This was actually released in the UK, so I have to use my special international DVD player that plays several regions to watch this. I can't watch it on the big screen. I have to watch it on my computer monitor back there. But it's a really, really nice set. This was given to me by a fellow YouTuber maybe a couple of years ago, and it is just really, really great. I know there's a Blu-ray release, box set release, that's out now, and I'm debating on getting that. I really have a fascination for these films, and I think that, you know, given the good and the bad, the Phantasm series is probably a series that I'm going to enjoy more than I dislike. But this is a slipcase. It comes off. Then, you know, you open it up, of course. And I'm not going to be able to show all this on camera, guys, because this is really, really huge. I couldn't even get it all in frame if I wanted to. So I'm probably going to have to do some editing and just show you guys the contents while I'm talking about it. But it's a really, really nice box set. There's special features on all the films in here. Now, this, of course, doesn't have the latest Phantasm film, Ravager, I believe it's called, because it was not out when this box set was put together. But it's a really epic set of DVDs, and I'm really, really glad to have it. Anchor Bay released this, and Anchor Bay does a really, really good job with their special edition releases, and this one is no exception. It actually has a almost 3D holographic cover here on the case itself. But like I said, I'm very, very glad to have this, and I'm possibly going to get the Blu-ray edition of this box set. But it's a really, really nice box set. But at any rate, I watched that Phantasm II from the box set, whereas I watched Phantasm I from the DVD that I had of it that plays here in America. And I was a little bit, I won't say upset, but I was a little bit irked by the ending of Phantasm, where, you know, the whole film is spent with these guys, you know, Reggie, Mike, and Jody trying to figure out how to stop the tall man, and, you know, fighting against him and avenging their friend's death, and just basically trying to put a stop to evil. And they did it. But what disappointed me about it was the fact that at the end of the film, it's like all that they'd done was just, you know, throwing the shit. And they didn't win. They neither won, and according to one of the characters, you know, it's partially a dream, and it's just like, what the hell, man? I mean, I really don't understand why some filmmakers invest the time in characters, invest the time in getting the audience to like these characters and to kind of, you know, really appreciate these characters, and then by the end of the film, they're either wiped out or something stupid happens. I don't really understand that. I don't get that. To me, if you're gonna write some fairly well-rounded, decent, likable characters, why screw them up at the end? It just makes no sense to me. I mean, it's almost like a cliche now. It's the end of the film, and we need something to shock people. So I was a little disappointed with the ending of Phantasm. And then, of course, here comes Phantasm II, which, let's check the ratings on that one. Now, generally, Phantasm, the original film, is considered the classic in the series, and probably rightly so, because it started it all. But Phantasm II on IMDb gets a 6.5. Rotten Tomatoes gives it a 38%. And Joe Blow gives it a 7 out of 10. Now, I don't believe that it's probably worthy of a 38% on entertainment value alone. But the film like the first film, is a little bit convoluted. There's elements of the story that are began, and you wonder why the film is going in this direction. And then by the end of the film, you're wondering why they never did anything with that, what they started. So I don't know. A 6.5, I could probably accept that on IMDb. Probably could accept that. Now, this film gets a lot of hell for the fact that when it was released, the actor that played the little, the teenage boy in the first film did not continue on in the role of the character that he played. And I didn't have a problem with that at all, because it supposedly was 18 years later. And granted, they could have got the same actor. I don't know why they did. Some of you Phantasm aficionados might be able to answer that question, but they didn't get him. And they got another actor who I thought was, you know, pretty likable actor. A little bit overly dramatic at times for me. His acting was a little bit weak at times. But, I mean, overall, I thought he did a decent job. I mean, I didn't have any problems like a lot of fans have had with him playing the character in the film. And let's go to the official IMDb page, because I want to see something right quick. It's taking forever to load, guys and girls. But let's see. James LeGros, or is it James LeGros, played Mike in the film. And like I said, overall, I didn't have a problem with him. The problem that I had were all story related and things of that nature. But the cast, I didn't have a problem with at all. I mean, you know, we still had Reggie Bannister as Reggie, and he's my draw to these films. As much as I liked Mike in the first film, I really do like Reggie. I think he's on par with Bruce Campbell in the Evil Dead films. To me, I saw a lot of similarities between Reggie and Bruce Campbell's character Ash in this movie. Although Ash would win hands down as far as who I like the best. But there were still some, I thought that they had a lot of elements that were similar. And one of the reasons I like Ash is because he's human. He gets scared. He doesn't just, you know, macho bravado just goes in, you know, nothing terrifies him. The man screams. I like the fact that he has frailties. And that's a lot of the reason why I like the fact that Reggie is very, very similar, because he has these exact same frailties. He screams, you know, he knows when he's in over his head. He runs when he has to. So I like that in a character. I like a character that just, you know, doesn't grab the machine guns and just, you know, let's go and I'm here to chew bubble gum and kick ass. Not that those characters are bad, but it's just, to me, adds a more realistic element when you have people that are, you know, fighting really weird things and they freak out. So Reggie, definitely Reggie had a big part in this one. He was a second bill to the main star. He got a lot to do. And I just found his character more entertaining. Whereas the actor that played Mike in the film, although he also got a lot to do, his character was really kind of subdued and kind of serious. And, you know, I want revenge. The tall man has to die. And I just found more enjoyment from watching Reggie. And there was a little bit of humorous elements about Reggie, too, that drew me into the character. So Reggie, if I think about the Phantasm franchise, the first thing I think about, other than the tall man, is Reggie. I really like the character of Reggie. He's just a lot of fun. And where we have a dark film that's like, you know, people dying, being embalmed and shrinking down and going to another dimension as a slave, you have Reggie that comes in where the humor isn't just over the top, but there is humor there, and I believe that it's a well-balanced humor. And it reminds us that, you know, this film isn't just all serious all the time. So I really like the Reggie character. Now, as far as the story goes, you know, the first one ended with basically Mike getting pulled through, was it a window or a mirror? And when this one opens, we learned that Mike's been in an asylum for 8 years. And apparently Reggie stayed in the same town where all this shit happens, I guess. Well, actually, he does stay in the same town, because he mentions that his aunt came to visit and they're all having this family gathering and everything. So Mike's in a asylum, and his brother, Jody, I guess, is dead in this movie. Mike believes the tall man killed him, and Reggie believes that Mike just had an accident on the highway. So, I don't know, guys. There seems to be a lot of confusion in these films, and it's almost like you gotta wonder if they didn't really have a completed story when they made this, because the concept is cool, but the execution is really, really weird. Because in this movie, we have this girl who kind of recounts the events in the first film. She has this psychic bond with the tall man, and she has a psychic bond with Mike. And throughout the film, she's saying, "Please, Mike, please come. Please, I need you. Help me." They both share this psychic bond, and almost to a romantic level, to where they really care about each other. But at the same time, she feels the tall man getting closer and closer to her. And she's like, "Mike, please help me. Please help me before the tall man gets here," and all this. And I'm just thinking, you know, where the hell did this come from? Why do we need a psychic bond? Why is there a psychic bond? What's this got to do with anything in the story other than just to advance the plot to where Mike has a reason to go and find this girl? I mean, to me, it would have made much more sense to just have him and Reggie drive to a town and just find the girl there. Because in the film, Mike's hell-bent on getting revenge against the tall man for all the evil he's done and killing his brother. And Reggie is a little bit reluctant at first, but when the tall man sets Reggie's family's house on fire and blows it up, he's all in. Now, and it's like the events in the film itself just make little to no sense, because, I mean, Reggie picks up Mike at the cemetery as he's digging up graves, and he's saying, "Reggie, look at this. There's no one in the caskets. The caskets are totally empty. All the bodies are gone. I've dug up three caskets, and there's nothing there." So Reggie's like, "Man, you got to stop doing this. You know, what do you want me to do about it? There's nothing I can do. We just need to go home and eat. My aunt cooked turkey. Just forget about all this stuff." And you're thinking, Mike, you were in the first film. You saw some of this shit. And you're just going to say, just forget it. The caskets are empty and you just want to go home and eat turkey? Okay, turkey. But anyway, they drive home and Mike has this psychic vision that he sees someone turning on gas in Reggie's house, and when they get there, the house explodes. And it's like, the tall man, this is what, it's like, what is the tall man's motives? What does he want with Mike? Why is he baiting Mike? Why is he playing jokes on Mike? Why is he putting a bomb or blowing up Reggie's house? How does he even know Mike's getting out of the sanitarium? Does Mike and the tall man share a connection? None of these questions are ever answered. I don't know what the hell's going on or why the tall man just happens to be inside Reggie's house. And I would say that maybe he sent the creatures to blow up the house, but when you see the burners being turned on the stove and the flashback in his mind, it's a regular hand, so it's not one of the creature's hands. So I'm just like, what's going on? But anyway, as entertaining as I think the film is, there's a lot of crap going on in this movie that just really makes no sense. But like I said, it's undeniably an entertaining film. I enjoyed the movie. But I can understand really why it gets a 6.5 on IMDb. And I'm sure it's because of the entertainment value of the film, because nothing makes much sense in the movie. So, you know, they decide to go after the tall man, which, you know, there's this montage of them talking and trying to find the tall man, and which makes you wonder in the first place, if the tall man's not in the town that they're in, who blew up the damn house when Reggie took Michael to his house? So anyway, it makes no sense, I tell you. So, you know, we're the whole time they're trying to find the tall man, and in certain cases, he set traps for them. And this is not shown but mentioned. There's traps where he's, I don't understand his motives, because, I mean, the traps are deadly. So I'm assuming he wants Michael and Reggie dead. There's some kind of connection between him and Michael. I don't know what it is, but does he want to change them into slaves and kill them? Does he want them dead? There's no clear, sight of what he really wants to do with these guys. And then, of course, you know, they keep traveling, and they meet this, they go into this one house in this town that he's been in, and the towns are just like, Mike says something like, it's not easy to track him, but it's been a year since we've been trying to track him. It's not easy to track, or it's not hard to track him, he says. So they get to this one town, they go in, and they find this girl that has this creature that jumps out of her back. And it's the tall man's voice, and he's just kind of taunting them on and everything. And I'm just thinking, this is the kind of trap you use? You taunt them on with a girl sitting in the corner with a blanket over and a creature just pops up just out of her back? How long has this girl been sitting here? I mean, how do we even know that Mike and Reggie would even come here? But anyway, if you're looking for any kind of sense in this movie, there's not really any sense to be made, man. So, you know, Reggie and him decide they're going after him. They go and make all these custom weapons. Mike makes a flamethrower. Reggie makes like a four-barrel shotgun. He gets two shotguns, cuts off the nozzles at angles, and welds them together. It shoots four bullets at a time, four shells. And you know, basically in the film, they finally meet the girl that's been given all these psychic signals. And when they meet, Mike runs to her like he's been knowing her forever. They embrace. They kiss. There's something between them. And eventually, while they're searching for the tall man, Reggie picks up a hitchhiker, which is also a girl. So we have another girl, a girl for Reggie and a girl for Mike. But his girl is a little bit low-key, other than a really weird sex scene between Mike and the girl. They don't really get to have sex, but just the whole way that she acts during the entire scene, it kind of gives a hint as there's something wrong with this girl. I kept expecting the girl to turn into a deadite or a demon or something, but it never happened. But you can obviously tell something's going on with this girl. But anyway, they finally find out where the tall man is, and they decide to go in and finally put an end to him. And, you know, without going into great detail, there's a fight between Reggie and one of the creatures that dig the graves and exhume the bodies. And it's very Evil Dead-esque. It's almost, I mean, if they had to put Ash in this fight, it would have fit in perfectly, because the fight is just a whole lot of a reminder of Ash fighting some creature. But anyway, entertaining fight. Reggie gets to deal with, you know, his evil, and then Mike gets to deal with his evil. The girl gets captured. She escapes. They confront the tall man. And in a nutshell, they make it all out. And seemingly, the tall man is finally stopped. So, the film from beginning to end, I didn't have a problem with, as far as, you know, I thought it was entertaining. I was entertained. It was nice to see Reggie. It was nice to see Mike again. And I enjoyed the chemistry between Mike and Reggie. I enjoyed the fact that Reggie is such a well-grounded character, and he seems like a real person. I enjoyed that. Now, while I could have walked away, given all the silliness in this movie and things not adding up, the girl having psychic power, which didn't amount to anything, I kind of thought that, well, maybe since she has psychic power, maybe the connection, or she's important to the tall man in some way. Maybe there's just something about her that makes her special. But obviously this is not true, because since she has this connection, one of the tall man's minions tries to actually cremate her and kill her. And then later on, when the tall man catches her, he tries to embalm her and, I guess, turn her into one of the creatures. So there's really nothing special about her. So the whole mind psychic thing in the story just means absolutely nothing. And then, just like the first film, when everything's wrapped up and the good guys have won, by the ending of the film, we have another downer ending where apparently the good guys are captured and taken by the tall man again. He shows up again. And then Reggie is, we don't know if he's mortally wounded or what, but he's left for dead on the highway. And it's like, would it be so fucking hard to just let these people win a fight? I mean, goodness gracious. You root for them throughout the entire movie. You watch Reggie struggle to fight the minions of the tall man. You watch Mike struggle with the tall man. And then when they win, they take the whole victory from you and just, you know, reverse course, and the bad guys won. And I'm just like, really? Really? That's what we want to do. We just want to have these guys lose all the time. So I don't understand the whole mindset in this. I don't understand why that seemed to be something they wanted to do. I don't get it. I mean, I think you could have had a much more enjoyable film if you just let the good guys win and then go on with a sequel. I mean, go on and have a sequel. There's one scene that's really strange where the tall man is, I don't remember exactly, but him and Mike are in close proximity. And Mike has him bound, or his arms around him, or he has his arms around Mike. And his head just opens up, and this little worm-like pincher thing comes out of his head. And you're thinking, is this the real tall man? Is this what they really look like? Well, obviously not, because Mike just pulls it out and throws it to the ground. But I'm like, what the hell is that? It's like they wanted to be creative, but in doing so, nothing really made any sense. There's one scene, a montage, where they make the weapons. Mike makes his flamethrower, Reggie makes a shotgun, welding the shotgun, and Reggie's looking at the gun and like, yeah, baby, this is going to really kick ass. And so in the film, later on, he's confronted by four of the little gnome-like creatures, and he uses a shotgun, blasts them, shoots all four of them to the ground, kills them. And then what does he do after that? He just throws a shotgun to the ground and leaves. I'm like, what? So, you know, like I said, guys, while I found Phantasm II entertaining, enjoyable to watch, there's just a whole lot of stupidity in the film that doesn't make any kind of sense. But like I said, it's a wild ride, and I liked it. And other than the ending, if the ending had been better, I would have gave it a higher rating, because, I mean, it just makes no sense to me to end the film the way they ended it. Because they can always create in another sequel, they could always create more circumstances in the next film. I mean, just have the tall man not die. You know, just have him learn that he's not dead. Just have him taunt Mike, since Mike has a telepathic power. Just have him send the message, "You lost, boy," or something. You don't have to have them win and leave the ending open, hoping that people will be like, "Oh my God, what happened? Well, what's going to happen next? We got to see. Are they going to make another one?" But anyway. So, good film, just a lot of silliness in the film as far as making the story make any sense. There's not much sense to be had in this film, but I enjoyed it. I'm glad to watch it. I'm glad that it's part of the collection, and I'm looking forward to the third film, which a lot of people say is really their favorite film in the series. I'm really looking forward to this one. But anyway, thanks for watching, everyone. There you have my thoughts on Phantasm II, and I will see you in the next Month of Horror video.